about this issue. Thanks.
Thank you. Of course, I choose the title as a tribute for the beloved disciple of our Lord Jesus Christ. And it's, this title shows that faith must go with science, and there is no opposition with between faith and science. Well, since century, observers have described the appearance of strange luminous sphere during thunderstorm. The sphere appears usually after lightning. This phenomena have been classified under the term of ball lightning. These luminous spheres are usually less than 1 meter in diameter. They can affect human, and sudden death from contact with ball lightning have been report. Ball lightning is a part of pop culture. Ball lightning can pass through glass window or enter the interior of metal cabin of plane. The ball lightning can sometimes melt metal and other times pass through paper curtains without igniting them. It is not known whether it is a single phenomenon or a series of phenomena that are of different nature. Of how to explain this phenomenon, how to find useful application for mankind, I will try to give you some answer during this presentation. There is more than 100 scientific theories to explain by ball lightning. Don't be afraid. I am not going to make an exhaustive bibliography. But this phenomenon was even denied by part of the academic world. Many believe that ball lightning was due to retinal persistence of the intense light emitted by the impact of lightning on the ground. I have twice witnessed the fall of lightning nearby myself, and I can tell you that the noise you hear does not sound that the classical hum of the thunder in the far view, but it's rather like a very loud banging of a whip on the ear, and it's very impressive. Well, I only quote. Okay. I will only quote some hypotheses. The classical hypothesis, chemical hypothesis, ball lightning will be a silicon sphere in combustion in the air. Other researchers said there is a chemical storage of the energy in an excited state of oxygen. Professor Ratis in Russia proposed a way of collective de-excitation of rare radioactive atoms present in the air. It's a kind of 3D radioactive laser. Ratis is a member of the Academy of Science of Russia. Recently, Tokarguin explained by lightning by self-focusing of light by a nonlinear effect. Some researchers propose the hypothesis of antimatter meteorite. The hypothesis of Nobel Prize Kapitsa in Russia is explained by lighting by the interaction of plasma and microwave. And this hypothesis received partial confirmation by Kopechkin in Russia. It's the first experimental device of Kopechkin's. It is in his home, in his personal laboratory. You can see one Tesla coil, another Tesla coil, the excitation, and the two Tesla coils are of different size, so they don't resonate at the same frequency. And in the dark, when the Tesla coil are energized, it's possible to see little sphere in the plasma. So, you know, the Russian like a big machine, and it is the second Kopeikine device built in a nuclear research center in Russia. One Tesla coil, another Tesla coil. And you can see a classical Kokoff-Walton accelerator in the back. It is probably Kurchatov Institute in Russia. And in the dark, it is possible to see a ball inside the spark. But during the thunderstorm, there is no microwave. There is another idea. Kelchunders proposed a shell made of electrons associated by a collective interaction. He called the sphere electron validum. Orozco proposed a model made of nested sphere of electron and proton. One of the most realistic hypotheses is that of plasmoid. The phenomena known today as plasmoid have been described for many years, notably by the great Tesla during his experiment at Colorado Springs. But the word plasmoid has been coined by Winston Bostick, for whom a plasmoid is a plasma magnetic entity. He said, the experimental observation suggests that the plasma travels even in field-free space, not at an amorphous blob, but at a structure called a plasmoid, whose form is determined by the magnetic field it carries with itself. Excuse my disastrous English. Please excuse my disastrous English accent. The term plasmoid for the Russian is a scientific name for ball lightning. There are two types of plasmoid. The SIFO plasmoid, there is a current, an electric current inside, and this current make a magnetic field outside. Excuse me, and the law of Maxwell made that when the currents diminish, there is an induction of a magnetic field, so there is a stabilization of this object during some seconds, a certain time. There is another class of plasmoid called Coffee plasmoid, current out, field in, field inside, an electrical current outside, and a strong magnetic field inside. And it is possible to show that this structure is also stable during a certain time. The team of Vlasov in Russia reported the creation of plasmoid by passing a strong current through a specially shaped coil. This coil is made of thin wire, and the wire is pulverized by discharging a strong high-voltage capacitor through it. So the author attempted to recreate plasmoid using Vlasov's coils of various shapes. This is a Vlasov coil. It's made with a very thin copper or palladium wire. This is a Vlasov coil. The diameter is 3 centimeters. So it's a very thin coil of copper. And if we discharge a strong battery of capacitor between these coils, there is a strong magnetic field inside, the capacitor explodes, became a plasma, and we could see a little sphere during only a fraction of a second. Here it's a bigger, it's in my lab, it's a bigger Vlasov coil. I use a styrofoam torus to try to mold the discharge. It's the beginning of the discharge, and it's the end of the discharge. But with the capacitor I used, I was not able to build stable plasmoid. I try also to make plasmoid with palladium wire charged with deuterium to see if it was possible to make cold fusion or lukewarm fusion. It's not totally cold, of course. It is a device used to charge the palladium Vlasov coil with deuterium. It is a platinum anode. The Vlasov coil of thin palladium wire. The EV water. The palladium inside. Here it's the device. It's a piece of silver and a paraffin block to see if there is a neutron. And it's after the shot, there is a little sphere. I was not able to make a beautiful photograph. It's very, very, very quick. But to be frank, with this experiment using Vlasov coil, I don't see neutron. So no clear replication of the ball lightning production. To be stable, plasmoid need probably a huge voltage and current produced by the discharge of biggest bank of capacitor. So it is not, Vlasov coil is not, for the moment, a good way to fusion. But the situation changed completely 50 years ago when a Russian researcher managed to reproductively make luminous plasmoid, luminous spheroid, which have all the characteristics of ball lightning. It's my friend, Dr. Shabanov, and he is making what's called a plasmoid. And you know, you see, it's he works in his office, not in a lab. It's very dangerous because under his desk, there is a big bang of high voltage capacitor. He takes this capacitor from the train, the company of the train of the railway in Russia. And he succeeded very with high reproducibility to make this ball of light. And the device used is very simple. A high voltage generator, a big capacitor, and a switch, a salad bowl full of water, an anode made of copper, and a cathode made of a little tube of glass with a little piece of graphite or copper inside. And when the switch is on, there is a discharge between the anode and the liquid, and it is possible to see a sort of luminous mushroom that our Russian friend called plasmoid. It's the Dr. Shabanov with a plasmoid, you know. The system is very simple. A bowl of water, a circular anode. The switch is only a stick of plastic, and of course it's very dangerous because the contact of with the bank of capacitor produce the death without any doubt. But the Russians are like this. They make bold hypotheses and bold experiments. Another picture. And it's very strange. There is some wave after the discharge, but the wave don't. The origin of the wave is not the cathode, but the origin of the wave is the wall of the recipient. So an explanation of ball lightning must take into account this observation. This is a ball lightning. So, in the recent years, the number of publications has increased in a prestigious organization, Max Planck Institute, US Navy Laboratories, American University, Russian Academy of Science, Yoffe Institute, Kurchatov Institute. Our Russian friend inherited from the Soviet time a different way of doing science. Even among academics, there is no taboo subject. The fatal notion of voodoo science is unknown in Russia, and researchers were free to choose new research of topics that would seem strange or incongruous in the West. In the field of low energy nuclear reaction, we must quote the remarkable works of Yuri, the late Yuri Bazutov, Alexander Karabut, Vladimir Vygotsky, Alexander Parkhomov, and Katya Belousova. I am forgetting the name of many Russian researchers who deserve to be caught, such as Professor Philippe Kanareff, who did research about the improving of water electrolysis at Krasnodar University. Many of the scientists are now working with extremely modest financial means. They are often forced to make their own experimental equipment, but in return, they can work in an atmosphere of remarkable academic freedom. Shabadov plasmoids have been reproduced by many teams around the world, including Max Planck Institute, Air Force, University of Illinois, Los Alamos. There is a lot of study with spectroscopy, plasma diagnosis, and very, very lot of results, but contradictory results. Some authors measure high temperature inside, other authors measure low temperature inside the luminous ball. So, there is a need for an explanation of this phenomenon. It is the beginning of the formation of the ball lightning. There is a sort of creeping discharge in the surface of the water, and at the end there is a sort of a luminous mushroom and then a ball. Then a luminous ball during 1, 2, 3 seconds. This is my experimental device. First, I don't want to be electrocuted, so I try to improve the security of the device. A big capacitor. Here, I had a key. It's a safety key to ground all the device. After each experiment, to be sure that it's possible to change the ball. I made the ball, I made recipient container of different size, and a lucid and a polymethyl methacrylate shield to avoid accident. And I use, of course, something to an helmet to protect my ear. I use a pedal as a switch to control the switch at distance. And I use many type of removable container. It's possible to plug the container. So there is an anode and a cathode. And the solution is tap water or copper sulfate solution, but the best result are obtained with tap water. It's I use two type of capacitor, commercial capacitor of two battery of 200 microfarad, and I made special capacitor of 100 microfarad, but with very low inductance. I build a winding machine to make myself the high voltage capacitor. So when closing the circuit, there is first a creeping water film coming from the cathode, and the strong electric field causes the water to creep to touch the water, the solution in the main container. So when the contact is made, there is an arc discharge. It is I have photoshopped this picture to enlighten the form of the discharge. There is a sort of umbrella, and what is causing the form of the bubble, in my opinion, it is the magneto-hydrodynamic force. There is the Laplace force who blows the arc to form a sort of umbrella by the classical rule of the three fingers. And the plasma umbrella is blown by its own magnetic field. And at the end of the discharge, the liquid is pulled away. It is sucked by the strong electric field at this place. So the water, the solution climbs 1 or 2 centimeters. And after the interruption of the discharge, the water fall down, and it is what produces this strange centripetal wave. In order to estimate the density of the gas inside the plasma, I made what I call pseudo Schlieren experiment. Schlieren is it's a classical optical technique used in to diagnostic the plasma and the shock wave. I use a very an arc lamp called an old device called point-o-lit lamp, a screen, and the point-o-lit lamp produced a very strong white light. On the screen, I can see the shadow of the luminous object. And by comparison with helium, with carbon dioxide, I am able to say that the density inside the luminous object is around the density of helium, perhaps under the density of helium. So the luminous object have also paradoxical property. They are stopped by sheet of paper without setting them on fire, but in other conditions they could make melt metal wire. So we must explain this fact. In a more strange way, Shabanov and collaborator show that when using a very classical helium neon laser, the laser seems to attract the plasmoid. It's very strange because the laser is very, very feeble. It's like a pointer, some milliwatt. So we must explain this fact. I use a big electromagnet and I pass the Gachina luminous object near the point of maximum magnetic field, and I saw that there is not a great action of magnetic field. It's very strange. If the Gachina plasmoid are really plasmoid. So my hypothesis is that is not that ball lightning, an artificial ball lightning, and probably natural ball lightning are not plasmoid, but simply bubble of hydrogen in ascension. Very pure hydrogen, and there is a steady and combustion producing. It's a flame. It's a spherical flame. It's a chemical process, in fact. So it's not exotic plasmoid. The explanation is more simple, and it's possible to prove this with laser. The luminous object change the direction of laser. Of course, I use a laser like this, and I pass the luminous ball in the laser, and at 10 meters, I could see that the luminous ball act at divergent lengths. So it is probably a bubble of hydrogen. Conclusion, the surprising observation led us to formulate a new hypothesis. The Gachina plasmoid will not be plasmoid in the sense of Bostik, but could simply be very pure hydrogen bubble in ascension. In the air, this bubble will be consumed in contact with oxygen, and the light observed will be only the result of the flame caused by the combustion of hydrogen stained by the metal ion contained in the solution. But there is a question. First, who made something useful for mankind? And when during classical electrolysis, there is at the cathode hydrogen and at the anode oxygen. In our experiment, where is the oxygen? It's a great question. So I made other experiment. I will conclude. In my opinion, there is not at the anode, there is not this classical reaction. There is a new reaction. I propose the term shock electrolysis. At the anode, there is this reaction in the container, hydrogen at the cathode, and at the anode, formation of peroxide of oxygen. And this peroxide of oxygen stay in the solution. I try to prove that peroxide of hydrogen was in the solution. So what is the utility? First, it is possible to make an electrolysis who produce only hydrogen, high purity hydrogen, and there is a great technical problem when we try to store the energy in the form of hydrogen. Because during the electrolysis, at the cathode and at the anode, there is a little wall of bubble. This phenomenon is called polarization. And polarization made that it is not possible to get a yield superior to 40% in the transformation of electricity in hydrogen. And it is a great problem because if we want to make the society, if we want to enter the hydrogen era, we must find a new way to store the electrical energy in the form of hydrogen. But with a plasmoid, there is no polarization because the electrolysis is made between a gaseous cathode. It's a classical electrolysis. If we try to raise the voltage, we don't get a higher yield. We get simply light and bubble and noise, but the yield falls to ridicule value. It's a Wenelt-Wollaston effect, and this effect is used by our colleague who tried to reproduce the Mizuno experiment of cold fusion. I will make the conclusion. Please notice that our hypothesis will provide a credible explanation for the phenomenon of ball lightning, a lightning strike of negative polarity falling on the surface of a lake, a puddle, a marsh, or a wet surface, will produce big bubble of hydrogen. Of course, there is not a magnetohydrodynamic forces like in our experiment, but with a big volume of hydrogen, the effects could be spectacular. Conclusion, our results therefore suggest that the ball lightning, this mysterious phenomenon observed for centuries, could be, perhaps, at the base of a new process of storage of the electrical energy in the form of hydrogen, and could allow the fast development of the renewable energy of which the world is in urgent need in order to manage the global warming. Thank you for your attention.
Okay.